Good afternoon. Being the last speaker has got its own advantage as well as disadvantages. So I try to, one of the key disadvantages is that people are tired of listening. So I try to be as short and sharp as possible. The second part was that since the topic was citizen-centric service delivery, so I considered it not to limit with e-service delivery, because the moment we talk about service delivery, we end up being e-service delivery and can then keep talking what is possible and don't necessarily figure out what has actually happened on the ground. So my perspective was to look at service delivery from its original perspective and try to figure out if technology actually do have a place there. A quick bird's eye view of what we understand about public service delivery. Significant investment actually has happened by the government, both at central and state level, and it has actually resulted in a reasonable degree of success in providing access to basic service. I'm very categorical about the word access, because while some states have recorded significant accomplishment, overall, the consolidated outcome of public service investment are not encouraging. There are enough studies, evidence out there, but that the fact remains that the outcome is not yet encouraging. And this has resulted, at least for some of the progressive state, to go for the legal entitlement route on declaring right to service, to say that to ensure delivery of defined category of services within a stipulated time frame to the citizen. And we also need to recognize that when we talk about services, this is basically service of to education, healthcare, roads, transport, PDS, the entire plethora of services we're talking about. Systemic, so I think there's nothing new I'm talking about here. I just wanted to consolidate corruption. Huge issue. I don't know how many of you have heard about a very interesting initiative happening in Bangalore called I Paid a Bribe. It's initiated by a retired bureaucrat, Mr. Raghunandan, who has taken voluntary retirement and set up this together with Janagraha, where if you are forced to pay a bribe to access a service, you can go and at least unburden yourself there, and based on that, there are actually analytics and algorithms are built, which has been used to engage with the government to address what we call the pain point of corruption. So that's an issue one needs to address. This is compounded with the monopoly power of sole service provider, and when I say sole service provider, it's not necessarily state service provider, but many of the private service provider, but they have got a soul, and therefore they monopolize, and therefore they basically, the recipient has to undergo the tyranny of receiving those services. We are aware of bureaucratic complexities and capacity gaps. I think that's an issue which needs to be really, really addressed. And fourth, which I think we as citizens are equally responsible, is very weak accountability mechanism. There is not enough civic pressure to demand service quality and standard. All of us try to say, as long as I'm getting my range of service okay, so who cares? There's not enough collective action by citizens groups yet, apart from isolated examples at various places, to demand for services. In this context, I was trying to define based on the work done by many of the researchers on the benchmark of effective public service delivery. And that's where I want to come back again, saying that why I was not limiting it to e-service delivery. Work by many researchers across actually indicate that we can benchmark the service delivery into four: access, information, equity, efficiency and responsiveness. And while listening to Mr. Suri, I could actually apply that entire benchmark very, very easily to the service delivery engagement which you have initiated on that. And if you see out here, there is information is only one of the four key benchmark, and therefore trying to propagate the idea, and I'm very clear that coming from an ICT background, I'm saying that they're trying to propagate that everything can be addressed through an e-service solution is not true. E-delivery is not the panacea. The fact is that E needs to be deployed appropriately in the service delivery value chain so that the service is delivered effectively. I'll come to an example before I end. Around this benchmark, therefore, I try to look at three principal aspects of instruments of improving service delivery. One is process innovation for simplifying transaction. People undergo pains only when handling complex transaction. And in the process innovation aspect, a lot of e-enablement can happen, has happened. There are examples across the country showcase that. But there are two other important aspects. Decentralization. I think we talk a lot about this, but in reality, which I was telling in one of the academic forum, the principle of decentralization operates that it's a great idea as long as the decentralization is happening only to my level, not below me. And I think that's an issue still need to be addressed. The second is enhancing public accountability. We, as a citizen, has got a responsibility to hold the service provider accountable. There are enough tools, both offline, which is traditional tools, some of them cited here, but also social media or many other those kind of e-enable techniques to create a larger accountability demand and a discourse and probably a movement for ensuring better quality of service. We get ultimately the service which we demand for and we are ready to fight for. There are some couple of examples. I'll not go into detail. All of them are basically drawn from the best practices repository of Governance Knowledge Center, which we run together with Government of India. But then I would take up the first two because of their very innovative nature to spend probably 30 seconds each. The first one is geoinformatics for forest rights. This is where the Tribal Research and Training Institute in Pune has used GPS devices to ensure quick clearance of claims which the claimant make under Forest Rights Act. And the problem here was that if you go through a traditional method of surveying and then figuring out whether the vegetation existed before 2005, it would take probably 4 years. So that's where through this process, once again, it's there on the case study. There's a case study on this. These transactions are curtailed down to something to around 45 to 60 days from filing an application. And you can see very high-end technology has been used at the back, while at the front end, it's a common transaction of an applicant submitting an application and getting his or her application either approved or not approved. The second one, which we have done together with Rural Development Ministry and UNDP in Rajasthan, of getting a illiterate NREGA worker access to information without making him or her to learn how to use a computer, but they